For those of us like me that work in the legal field in the constitutional area, there's one area of the law that has become a very naughty area and a very strange area, and that's the area of mentioning God in schools by little children, mentioning religion. In fact, I'd say God has become the four-letter word in most public schools in the United States. Children at school can mention about anything they want to in schools, even other four-letter words, all kinds of very strange subjects. But when it comes to talking about religion or God or Jesus or Buddha and those type of things, all of a sudden it becomes taboo. One reason we see this is there are some active secularistic groups out there that either secularistic or atheistic that push a very strong secular agenda that the goal is to completely secularize American society. But you really see it in the cases that come across my desk, and we get quite a few pleas for help from parents. Let me give you a few of the cases that we just recently confronted that raise a real serious issue. One concerned a young fourth grader out in Colorado who was given an assignment by his class. The class was told to come dress up like a hero on Hero Day. Kids came in all kinds of different costumes. Well, this little character, a nine-year-old child, came dressed as Jesus. Well, when the school found out what his plans were, they called the parents and said, you pick another hero, it doesn't matter, but you can't come as Jesus. Parents got visibly upset. So at that point, the school, facing a possible lawsuit, the parents had contacted the Rutherford Institute. The school all of a sudden, he can come as little Jesus, but he can't give his presentation, which was like a paragraph, three or four sentences in front of the class. He has to do it in private, away from everybody else, in front of the teacher. So it sends a really bad message to the child. That is that Jesus is not a worthy hero and that religion is something bad, something to be avoided. Another case that recently came across my desk, during our past December, a student was asked why they liked the month of December. And she said, I like it because it's Jesus' birthday. She wrote this down on a piece of paper and we get to celebrate it. The teacher said, no way, you can't talk about that subject in school. It's illegal. Do we really want a society where we can talk about virtually anything in a public school and in public institutions except God or Jesus or Buddha or Yahweh or Muhammad? Is that the kind of society we really want? Then the bigger question is, why philosophically has all this happened? Well, there have been a number of people who have written on it. One is Christopher Lash and a number of social scientists, but basically what's happened is the elitists, the people who run American society from the public education system to certain governmental institutions and figures, have basically decided that God's irrelevant to public discussion. What this does, this ignores the 120 million plus people in America that take their religion seriously, they practice it, and who pay taxes to support institutions like the public schools. And what it does is it forces these people and their religion and their beliefs, their religious and free speech beliefs, to be subservient to all other beliefs. Of course, the reason usually given is we've got to have separation of church and state in America. But the issue in these cases is not separation of church and state. It's what we used to have in the former Soviet Union and what we have in countries like China now. It's religious believer versus the state. There are no churches. These are individuals that just want to exercise their free speech. Contrary to the propaganda that we often hear from secularist groups and others, the people who founded this country, who wrote our Constitution, who set the basic foundations of America were not anti-religious. They were religionists, most of them were. Thomas Jefferson, who coined the phrase separation of church and state, which is often used, was right to say the church should not be intermeddling in government or running governments. But he did not want to seal religion off from government. He did a number of things to promote religion in government. In fact, Jefferson was so religious and so admired Jesus that he, on two occasions, went to the New Testament, cut it down, took out the virgin birth and the miracles, and boiled down the teachings of Jesus. And one time while he was president of the United States. And he came to the conclusion near the end of his life, and he wrote this in a letter, that Jesus' teachings were the most sublime ever. The greatest moral teacher of all time was Jesus Christ, even greater than all the ancient philosophers. The Northwest Ordinance of 1787, which set up public education in the United States, promoted religion in public schools. Let me read to you the relevant section. Religion, morality, and knowledge being essential to good government and the happiness of mankind, schools and the means of education shall forever be encouraged. So religion was a basis of our government, our schools in the beginning. Even the textbooks in early schools up until into the 20th century would make reference to God and the beliefs that many people in this country have without embarrassment. But what I'm not saying here is that we don't want to force religion in school. What we want is for every American child and parent to have the same rights if they're religious, if they're atheist, to have their free speech rights in the public schools. What this demands is an equal voice for everyone, no matter what your religion is or your beliefs. It just doesn't really matter. America stands for a lot of things, but it stands for that principle of equality. If we don't ensure that, and I work in the area of constitutional law, if we start taking subjects and say these are taboo, you can't talk about them, what we're going to end up with is a secular state that respects nobody's opinions at all.